Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 24th May 2020. These are the news articles chosen for today's discussion, and they belong to different areas of UPSC syllabus such as International Relations, Geography, Science and Technology, Biodiversity, etc. The page numbers for these news articles from different editions of Hindi newspaper is also given here for your reference. Along with this, the handwritten notes provided in this discussion will be available in the PDF format in the description box and also in the comment section. Let's move on to the first news discussion for today. The first discussion for today is based on this news article, which reports about a massive data breach that was carried out on job and resume aggregator services. In the analysis of this news article, we will see about Darknet in detail, like what it is, how it is used, what are its features, who are using it, how payments are done, etc. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. See, through the data breach reported in the news, a cyber criminal gang has taken control of personal information of about 2.9 crore Indian individuals. Cyber criminals use such personal information for carrying out identity thefts, scams, corporate espionage, and also for a wide range of illegal activities. And it is said that the personal data of these individuals were found to be available for free download in the darknet. This was confirmed by a US-based cyber intelligence firm called as Cybel Inc. And the news article states that the leak of data was made to get attention, and the strategy which was used is same as the strategy which was used by a hacking group called as Shiny Hunters. See, these Shiny Hunters were in news earlier this month for the data breach which they carried out in various firms such as Tokopedia and others. Here, know that Tokopedia is an Indonesian e-commerce platform. So in this context only, in today's scenario, darknet is very important. And whenever we learn about darknet or dark web, we will also be hearing the term deep web. Deep web refers to those data or content in the web that a typical search engine like Google is unable to find. A large chunk of the internet is still untouched by the ordinary world, and the World Wide Web, which we see, is only the tip of an iceberg. See, internet has around 4 billion websites existing on servers around the globe. And for the most of the people, the web is limited to less than 100 websites. And majority of this limited collection is in the form of Google sites and services. So what are available in deep web? Government databases, libraries, writings of activists in countries that have strict internet control, and several other things are available in the deep web. Even a private network that is out of reach of standard search engines can be tagged as deep web. And know that most of the deep web contains nothing harmful, and it consists mainly of databases, libraries, and academic writings. In simple terms, deep web is nothing but that part of the internet that is not accessible by normal search engines. While most of the deep web is harmless, a small part of it is still harmful. And this is where darknet comes into play. So what is darknet then? Darknet is also known as dark web. It is a small portion of the deep web. And this small part of deep web is intentionally hidden, and it is made inaccessible through regular search engines. So darknet is a subset of deep web. And most of the criminals, terrorists are found on this portion of internet, which is nothing but the darknet. So what is the most popular browser that is used to explore the contents in the darknet? It is the browser which is known as Tor or the Onion router. And Tor is the short form of this, the Onion router. Now Tor can be used to visit normal internet websites, but it also has numerous hidden websites and services which cannot be accessed on the regular internet. And the Onion router's protocol is called as the Tor Hidden Service Protocol instead of the Hypertext Transfer Protocol, which is HTTP that is normally used in a web link. Now, the feature of Tor is that both the clients and servers do not know the IP addresses of each other. IP addresses usually help in investigations to reach the device that is used by a criminal or the network which is accessed for the criminal activity. But identifying the IP address of a device that used Tor is reportedly said as very difficult. Experts say that with traditional methods, one may not be able to locate a criminal who used the Onion router. Apart from this, there are also friend-to-friend networks in the darknet. Such networks can be encrypted or password protected, for which only the concerned people have the access. So with respect to anonymity in the darknet, both web servers and website publishers are entirely anonymous. IP addresses are masked or hidden by software. There are large number of proxy servers in various countries, and data related to search about a criminal is redirected to many servers, and each time the network is accessed. This makes it difficult to track a person operating in the dark web. Now, if you ask how the websites will look like in a dark net, see, generally they are poorly designed. They are not visually appealing, and many of them appear as basic Excel sheets only. The emphasis is on functionality and it is not on aesthetic appeal like in a normal website. It is said that it is difficult and time consuming to find exactly what a person is looking for. So finally, who are the users of darknet? See, legitimate users like cyber experts, journalists, activists, whistleblowers, etc. also use darknet to communicate with other experts or agencies. Even security agencies, government and law enforcement organizations are also the users of the hidden internet, but they operate for intelligence and investigation purposes only. Now, because of the anonymity it provides to the users, darknet is very popular for illegal activity. Terrorists use darknet particularly through the Onion router for anonymity, and even other criminals use it for the same. And then darknet is used by terrorist groups to communicate, recruit new members, to raise funds, to procure weapons, to spread propaganda, and even to plan operations. So based on this, you could have assumed what are the services offered in the darknet. Most commonly, traded illegal items are sold for criminals. Then items such as hacked mobile accounts, internet banking accounts, drugs, fake passports and other IDs, then child pornography. Then it also has resources on the preparation of explosives and toxins also. And there are also forums in darknet, chat rooms, and a number of websites belonging to extremist groups. There are also guides to various forms of cyber crime. There are weapons for sale, as we already saw, and there are video tutorials also on how to use these weapons. And there are also killers for hire in this darknet. So you can see that the darknet mainly offers illegal criminal services. Apart from this, with respect to payment services, cryptocurrencies, generally Bitcoin is used for both illegal and legal transactions. So it means things are out of reach from an ill-equipped, traditionally operating central bank. So as a whole from this discussion, you would have got an idea that whatever we term as illegal is available in this darknet. And that is why this topic is important from exam perspective. So that is all about darknet. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The respective practice question will be discussed in the last session. Let's move on to the next discussion. Now, this news article talks about the China's Belt and Road Initiative. And the news article mentions that there is a shift in China's BRI approach. So in this discussion, we'll first see about the Belt and Road Initiative, and then we will see about the shift. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. As we all know, BRI is China's ambitious program to connect Asia with Africa and Europe via land and maritime networks. You can see these networks in this picture. And this is to improve the regional integration, to increase trade, and also to stimulate economic growth. Now, as you know, BRI comprises of a Silk Road economic belt. And this is a transcontinental passage that links China with Southeast Asia, South Asia, Central Asia, Russia, and Europe by land. And BRI also comprises of a 21st century maritime Silk Road. And this maritime Silk Road is a route connecting China's coastal regions with the Southeast and South Asia, the South Pacific, the Middle East and Eastern Africa. And also it connects all the way to Europe. So this is the little background about Belt and Road Initiative. And we know that India did not join BRI even after receiving multiple invites from China. So what is the reason for this? What are India's concerns and why is India reluctant to join BRI? The reason behind this is because many countries see BRI as a Trojan horse. You would have heard this term with respect to a malicious program in computer. But if you see, when you describe a thing as a Trojan horse, you mean that they are being used to hide someone's true purpose or intentions. So countries compare BRI as China's Trojan horse because they see this initiative as a China-led regional development and military expansion. In addition to this, the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, or the CPEC, also passes through Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, so it undermines India's sovereignty. And know that CPEC is a flagship initiative of BRI. Now, apart from these reasons, India also outlines few principles which are directed against the China's BRA. First principle is, it must be based on universally recognized international norms, good governance, rule of law, openness, transparency and equality. But China's BRA is not transparent and it also has an unequal sphere of influence of China over the small countries. We will see in this discussion itself what this means. Now, the second is that such an initiative must follow principles of financial responsibility to avoid projects that would create unsustainable debt burden for communities. Now, this point is mentioned because many allege that China is following a debt trap diplomacy. That is, China is intentionally creating unsustainable debt to small nations and it is increasing its military presence there. For example, if you take Sri Lanka, it took loans for infrastructure projects from China. Now, this raised Sri Lanka's debts to China to $8 billion. But Sri Lanka is in a position where it cannot repay the debt. So, it negotiated for a debt for equity swap of the Hambantota port project. Now, this swap has led to protests in the country of Sri Lanka. And that is why this reason is a primary concern of India. Because China is bringing all the neighbors of India to its sphere of influence and thus it threatens India's security. Now, the third principle which must be followed in such an initiative is the balanced ecological and environmental protection and preservation standards. But as it is said that China's BRI can be achievable only at the expense of ecology and environment. So, there is no protection to ecology and environment. Then the fourth principle that should be followed is the transparent assessment of project costs. We all know that China and Chinese administration is not known for transparency. Often many countries accuse China's BRI for opaque bidding process and it also requires the use of Chinese firms only to build infrastructure in other countries. So this eliminates the transparent assessment of project costs. So these are some among the many reasons which India cites for abstaining from BRI. And apart from this, as we also know, China is not good for India's economic and security interests. And we have already seen China's aggressive stand in Doklam in 2017. And recently we are seeing it in Ladakh and Sikkim also. However, many countries, including Indian neighbors, joined BRI. So because of it, to counter BRI, India and Japan proposed to develop the Asia-Africa Growth Corridor. And this Asia-Africa Growth Corridor or AAGC is a plan to develop and connect ports from Myanmar to East Africa. And the Quad grouping is believed to be a countermeasure to China's political and economic influence also. As you know, the Quad is an informal grouping between countries of India, Australia, Japan and USA. And this group is seen as a regional counterweight to China. And it is seen as a grouping to counterbalance the rising China's influence in the Indo-Pacific. So these are India's response to this China's grand BRI. So why is it in news today? It is because of certain recent developments. We just discussed that BRI infrastructure projects are not sustainable and they lead to massive debts for partnering countries. Now this situation was further aggravated by the COVID-19 pandemic. As a result of this, many partnering countries in Asia and Africa have asked China to delay or waive the debt repayments because we know that the world economy has come to a standstill due to this pandemic. Now in this scenario, China's premier has said that China will focus on quality in the joint pursuit of the BRI. And this is what is considered as a major shift in China's BRI approach. See, previously, China did not mention the term quality in its 2018 report, which talked about BRI. The previous report says that China will promote the joint pursuit of BRI. It also mentioned that China would seek to advance infrastructure connectivity, but this was also omitted this year. Now, this change is seen as important because the report is usually carefully assessed to garner changes in the Chinese policy making. Now, since the terminology is mentioned in the report is modified, the news article has anticipated that there is a shift in BRI's approach. And it is said that due to the rising debt concerns, China is worried about its magnum opus project, which is BRI. Hence, it has signaled this shift in its approach. So, in the future, we will see what this shift actually means. So, that is all about this discussion. In this discussion, we saw about BRI and why India has not joined BRI. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion, which is based on this FAQ article. This article discusses about the Kalapani dispute, which we have been seeing for past several days. But this particular article focuses on the strategic importance of Kalapani. So we will see that today. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. Just basically know that Kalapani is a disputed territory between India and Nepal. River Mahakali flows through Kalapani, which is situated on the eastern bank of the river. And both India and Nepal claim Kalapani as integral part of their territories. Where India claims Kalapani as a part of Uttarakhand's Pitharagarh district and Nepal claims Kalapani as a part of its Dharchula district. And in these maps, you can clearly see that how India and Nepal include Kalapani as their territory. See, already the geographical aspects and the historical aspects of this region have been explained in our other Hindu News analysis. Like we discussed it yesterday, we discussed it on May 11, 2020 and also on November 2019 Hindu News analysis. But today, as I already said, we'll just discuss the strategic importance of this region, which is mentioned in this FAQ. This Kalapani holds great geostrategic importance, mainly because of its location. Because Kalapani is a tri-junction point where Indian, Nepalese and Tibetan borders meet. So because of this, firstly, they are geostrategically and geopolitically important because it helps India to keep an eye against any attempt of encroachment by China or the movement of People's Liberation Army of China towards India. See, ever since the 1962 war with China, India has deployed the Indo-Tibetan border police at Kalapani. And it is advantageously located at a height of over 20,000 feet and thus it serves as an observation post for that area. And secondly, the region is also important for religious reasons. This region has been used for centuries by Hindu and Buddhist pilgrims and tourists on their way to Kailash Mansarovar. Then when the pilgrimage to Kailash Mansarovar was paused when Chinese forces took over Tibet in the mid-1950s, India deployed troops at the Lipulake Pass in the year 1959. But later, through the 2015 Lipulake Agreement, which was signed between India and China, India's Mansarovar pilgrimage connection was renewed. But here you should note that both India as well as China neither consulted Nepal nor sought Nepal's opinion before signing this agreement. So that is why this FAQ article mentions it as a clear violation of Nepal's concerns or Nepal's sovereignty over the region. But at the same time, if you see, during certain occasions, Nepal's new generation leaders have spoken against the Sugauli Treaty and they mentioned that this treaty is irrelevant. Yesterday, we saw that this treaty clearly shows that Nepal's claim over the region is not consistent with the treaty. And as you know, suddenly this region has become an issue again because to facilitate the easy movements of pilgrimages, on 8th of this month, a new 80-kilometer road was inaugurated by India. And this road is from North India, that is from Delhi to Kailash Mansarovar. And it goes right up to the Lipulake Pass on the line of actual control. This new road is the shortest and direct route from North India to Kailash Mansarovar and it passes through Uttarakhand. And as we just saw, the road goes right up to the Lipulake Pass on LAC, through which Kailash Mansarovar pilgrims exit India into China to reach the mountain. And here know that Mount Kailash is a 6,638 meter high peak in the Kailash range, which forms part of the Trans-Himalaya in the Tibet Autonomous Region of China. The mountain is located near Lake Mansarovar and Lake Rakshasthal. And as you know, Mount Kailash is considered to be sacred in four religions, the Bon religion, Buddhism, Hinduism, and also in Jainism. Now coming to the another importance of this region, the region is important in geo-economic aspect as well. See, since 2009, India and China have repeatedly tried to develop Lipulake Pass as a bilateral trade route by bypassing Nepal. And this is supposedly because that is what India wants. On the other hand, China is also keen on the development of Tibet. Here, China believes that Tibet can develop only via great linkages with India because, as the world knows, we are an economic giant and that too next door to China. Apart from this, the new road which has been built is also expected to provide better connectivity to Indian traders for the India-China border trade at the Lipulake Pass. And this road will enable the trade between June and September every year. So that is all about this discussion. In this discussion, we saw why the Kalapani region is so important from Indian perspective. We saw the geostrategic, geopolitical, religious, and also economic reasons behind the importance of this region. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. Let's move on to the next discussion. The next discussion is based on this question, which has been framed with reference to the few important locations mentioned in these news articles. These news articles deal with the boundary issues between India and China with reference to the line of actual control, that is LAC. We have discussed recently in our news analysis about the boundary issues with two neighboring countries. One is China and the other is Nepal. And already we have discussed a news article based on the boundary issues with Nepal. Now, this FAQ article mentions that India and China did not actually had much of an issue when it comes to two locations. One is in the border with Sikkim, then other is in the Galwan Valley or the Galwan Valley in the Union Territory of Ladakh. But these two locations were part of recent tensions between India and China. Then apart from this, two more areas in the Union Territory of Ladakh were also involved in the recent tensions. One is in the northern bank of Pangong Lake and the other is Demchok. So remembering these areas from examination point of view is very important. Now with reference to the three sectors of borders among India and China, there is huge divergence in line of actual control in the western and eastern sectors. See, when we say western sector, it corresponds to the Union Territory of Ladakh. And the eastern sector corresponds to the Sikkim and Arunachal Pradesh. And also know that the middle sector corresponds to the border in the states of Himachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand. Now, according to India, China has illegally occupied 38,000 square kilometers in Aksai Chin in the Union Territory of Ladakh. And in the east, China has occupied as much as 90,000 square kilometers, which includes most areas in Arunachal Pradesh. Now, with respect to Arunachal Pradesh, there is one more sticking point. This is about the Tawang region. The stand of China with respect to this region is that the disputed territory in the eastern sector, including Tawang, is inalienable from China's Tibet. This is in terms of cultural background and administrative jurisdiction. And here you should note that Tawang is the westernmost district of Arunachal Pradesh. So with respect to these issues, the FAQ article concludes with a note made by a Chinese scholar in 2018. And this note can be used in mains answer writing also. And the note is, resolving border disputes is the result of improvement in bilateral relations and it is not the cause of improvement of relations between two countries. Now, this is particularly when China is involved. If you see, this actually counters India's approach that India's relations with China will not improve fundamentally until the border disputes are resolved. So, the author implicitly seeks improvement in relations between the two countries so as to resolve the issue amicably with due recognition to the mutual and equal security. Now, if we come back to this question, the question asks, which of the following places is or are located in the state of Arunachal Pradesh? Tawang, Galwan Valley, Pangong Lake, Demchok. So based on our discussion, you can easily say that Tawang is in Arunachal Pradesh and the remaining three are in Union Territory of Ladakh. So the correct answer to this question is option A, one only. So from this question, what you should note is whenever certain places which are of international importance and are of national importance appears in news again and again, you should note which state it belongs to, whether it is having any international dispute or not. This will help you a lot in the prelims examination. Now let us move on to the next question. Now this next question is based on cotton and cotton cultivation. And this question has been framed based on this news article which talks about cotton cultivation in India. We'll see what the news is afterwards. First, let us see some basic information regarding cotton. Know that cotton is one of the most important cash crops and it accounts for around 25% of the total global fiber production. It is also one of the most important commercial crops which is cultivated in India. And with respect to the characteristics of cotton, it is a tropical crop which is grown in Kharif season in the semi-arid areas of our country. But know that India lost a large proportion of cotton growing area to Pakistan during partition. But however, its acreage or the area of cultivation has increased considerably during the last 50 years. And know that cotton requires clear sky during flowering stage. And cotton is grown on a variety of soils. It is grown in well-drained, deep alluvial soils in the northern regions. Then it is also grown in black clayey soils in the central region. And it's also grown in the black soil and also a mixture of black and red soils in the southern zone. And one of important characteristics of cotton is that it is semi-tolerant to salinity and it is sensitive to waterlogging. And that is why it prefers well-drained soils. And with respect to India, majority of cotton production comes from 9 major cotton growing states. And these states are grouped into 3 diverse agroecological zones. They are Northern Zone, Central Zone, Southern Zones. And these are the states under these zones. And besides these states, cotton is also grown in the states of Tamil Nadu and Odisha. And cotton cultivation has also gained momentum in small areas of non-traditional states such as Uttar Pradesh, West Bengal, Tripura, etc. But know that there are some constraints with respect to cotton cultivation. See, nearly 65% of cotton area is rain-fed, mainly in the central states and southern states. Hence, its cultivation depends on monsoon. And cotton crop is highly prone to pests and diseases also. For example, pink bollworm is one of the most destructive pests of cotton. And there is also wild fluctuation in cotton prices. And there is inadequate market infrastructure, etc., etc. And remember, India is the largest producer of cotton in the world. But however, for the period 2019-20, it is projected that China's production will be marginally higher than India's cotton production. So what is the news today? The news is that governments of Haryana and Punjab have discouraged farmers from growing rice. So farmers in Punjab and Haryana have sown more cotton this Kharif season. And they are sowing cotton because it is less labor-intensive crop than paddy. And compared to paddy, cotton also requires less water and it can be cultivated in semi-arid areas as well, as we saw in the beginning. Now, with this background, if you look at this question, it mentions that cotton is a semi-arid crop and requires large amount of water compared to paddy. See, first half of this statement is correct. Cotton is a semi-arid crop. But whether it requires large amounts of water? No, it requires less amount of water compared to paddy. So, first statement is incorrect. Now, the second statement is India is world's largest producer of cotton in 2018-19. Now, this statement is correct because just now we saw that for the year 2019-20 only, it is projected that China's production is higher than India's cotton production. And here the question asks for the correct statements. So, the correct answer to this question is option B, 2 only. Let's move on to the next question. Now, this question is with reference to this news article which talks about heat wave condition prevailing in Odisha. A yellow heat wave warning has been issued by the Bhubaneswar Meteorological Center, which has advised people to avoid heat exposure till Wednesday. It is because the Titlagarh in Odisha has recorded the maximum daytime temperature of 45.5 degrees Celsius, while many observation stations in western Odisha also recorded temperature above 41 degrees Celsius. So in this juncture, let us see the definition of heat wave. According to the National Disaster Management Authority, heat wave is defined as the condition where maximum temperature at a grid point, or in other words, in a particular place, is more than the normal temperature by 3 degrees Celsius or more than 3 degrees Celsius. And this has to be pronounced consecutively for 3 days or more than 3 days. But if you see, according to the World Meteorological Organization, if the daily maximum temperature exceeds the average maximum temperature by 5 degrees Celsius, and this happens for 5 or more consecutive days, then it is called as heat wave. And one more thing here is that if the maximum temperature of any place continues to be more than 45 degrees Celsius consecutively for 2 days, then it is called as a heat wave condition. So, what can be the right temperature for human body? See, there will be no harm to the human body if the environmental temperature remains at 37 degrees Celsius. Whenever the environmental temperature increases above the 37 degrees Celsius, then the human body starts gaining heat from the atmosphere. And here know that if relative humidity is high, then a person can suffer from heat stress disorders even with the temperature at 37 degrees Celsius or 38 degrees Celsius. So, for same temperature, if the relative humidity is more, then a person is more vulnerable for heat-related disorders. Remember this also. So, what happens as a result of this heat wave condition? As we saw already, it leads to physiological stress among the humans. As a result of this, it can also claim the life of an individual. Then it also causes heat disorders such as sunburn, heat cramps, heat exhaustion, and heat stroke or sunstroke. Here, just know that sunstroke is a severe medical emergency that can take the life of an individual if the person is not provided immediate assistance. And with respect to India, if you see, as per the information given by the Ministry of Earth Sciences, in the 9-year period from 2010 to 2018, more than 6,000 people have died because of heat waves. So So that is why this topic is important, and that is why the Bhubaneswar Meteorological Center has advised people to avoid heat exposure. Now, with this background, if you look at this question, the first statement mentions heat wave is a condition of atmospheric temperature that leads to physiological stress, which sometimes can claim human life. This is correct. Here in this sentence, the condition of atmospheric temperature is important. Now, if you look at the second statement, it mentions as per IMD in the color signals for heat alert, red alert represents severe condition corresponding to extreme heat alert for the day. Now, in this image, you can see the different color signals for heat alerts, and you can see that red alert corresponds to extreme heat alert for the day. So that means both the statements are correct, and here the question also asks for the correct statements. So the correct answer to this question is option C, both 1 and 2. Now, this next question has been framed on Botanical Survey of India. It was in news because the BSI or the Botanical Survey of India has reported the discovery of 3 new plant species in the evergreen forest patches of the southern end of Western Ghats in Kerala and Tamil Nadu. Now, you might think why there is a need to discuss about new plant species. It is because if you look at this 2016 prelims question, they have asked about a new and distinct species of banana plant, which was recently discovered. So, whenever a new species is discovered, you please take a note of it. It will be helpful in prelims examination. Now, let us see these 3 new species discovered by Botanical Survey of India. The first one is Eugenia sperocarpa. It belongs to Myrtaceae family or the rose apple family. It is growing in the Kakayam area of Malabar Wildlife Sanctuary in Kerala, and it is growing above 800 meters. Here, know that the term sperocarpa denotes to the large, showy, lemon-yellow spherical fruits of this plant. Now, the second species is Goniothalamus sericeus. It belongs to the Anonaceae family of the custard apple. A small number of this plant has been found in the Kanyakumari Wildlife Sanctuary in Tamil Nadu, and it has been found at an altitude of 1400 meters. Now, mature flowers of this plant have greenish yellow to beige color petals, and these flowers are fragrant also. And in this, know that the term sericeus refers to the presence of dense silky hair on petals. Now, the third species is Memsiclon nervosum. It belongs to the Melastomataceae family. A small number of this plant was also found at the Kanyakumari Wildlife Sanctuary in Tamil Nadu, and it was found at an altitude between 700 meters and 900 meters. And it has showy purplish blue flowers, as you can see in this picture. So, these are the 3 new species found by BSI. Now, let us see some important facts about Botanical Survey of India. It is the Apex Taxonomic Research Organization of India. It works under the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. And it was established in the year 1890 to explore, to collect, to identify and also to document the rich plant resources in our country. And know that presently BSI is spread in 11 regional centers. And these are the objectives of BSI. Now, if you look at this question, it mentions consider the following statements with reference to Botanical Survey of India. First statement is, it is the apex research organization for carrying out taxonomic and florist studies on wild plant resources of the country. This is a correct statement. The second statement is, it comes under the Ministry of Earth Sciences. It is incorrect because just now we saw it comes under the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. And before marking the answer, note that this question asks for incorrect statements. So, here statement 2 is incorrect, hence the correct answer is option B, 2 only. Now, let us discuss the remaining mains questions which were displayed during the news article discussion sessions. This question is based on GS paper 2. The question asks, in the post-COVID-19 world, China's Belt and Road Initiative presents an opportunity to develop infrastructure and enhance economic growth in India. Critically examine. See, it is a critically examined question, so we need to take a critical stand on the given statement. It means we will talk more against the given statement. As an introduction, you can talk about how the world needs a lot of liquidity and infrastructural support to rebuild nations and to improve growth. And you can also mention some points supporting the given statement. You can write the positives for India by joining BRI, like it will be helpful in infrastructure building in India. Then India and China together as the third world countries can shape the world. Then you have to more focus on the arguments which are against this statement. Like you can mention that China's intention regarding BRI is not clear, whether it is following debt trap diplomacy. You can also mention that China and Pakistan are close, so India can have trust issues. And even China has an eye on Arunachal Pradesh, so India needs to be careful while dealing with China. And as a conclusion, you can mention India should join the like-minded countries like France, US, Japan and Australia to rebuild post-COVID world. And don't forget to add your own viewpoints and do not exceed the word limits. Now, this next question is on GS Paper 3. It is a very direct question. What is darknet? How much is darknet relevant for the operation of illegal activities? First, you have to define darknet. You can say it is a subset of deep web. Then you can little bit explain about deep web. Then you can say in darknet, contents are intentionally hidden and they cannot be accessed normally. And you can mention that the contents in darknet are harmful. Then it operates on the onion router, that is a Tor. So several criminal activities are taking place in darknet because of its anonymity. Then you have to answer the second part of this question. How much is darknet relevant for the operation of illegal activities? We discussed this during the discussion that various actions against the interest of governments and citizens can be planned and done in darknet because it breaks the barrier of need of physical travel. It breaks the barriers of basic principle of crime detection because the IP address is masked. So key evidences are not available when an illegal activity is carried out through darknet. So because of this, darknet can be a huge resource for criminal minds. Then as a conclusion, you can say use of cryptocurrency in darknet and the ill-equipped international and national finance mechanisms to deal with virtual currencies also favor the operation of illegal activities in the recent years. And in the following years, these are projected to increase only until the governments are equipped with necessary mechanisms to handle the illegal activities happening in darknet. And you can also add your own viewpoints and finish the answer. With this, we come to the end of today's Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share. And do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates related to civil service examination preparation.